Maybe I'd like to invite Dr. Sharat Damodar to come up and tell us a little bit about cell-based therapies, which are certainly sort of the cutting edge. And we'll have more talks on this theme, but
Thank you. Right. I think the entire theme for the day is looking at some of these therapies for specific diseases. And what I'm going to do over the next 10 minutes is kind of just give an overview from both a clinician's perspective and a patient's perspective of what to potentially look forward to in the next, say, 3 to 5 years in some of these rare diseases area. Now, just to give you one clip of, you know, this is from a Nature article. And if I just quickly run through, we've already spoken about what rare diseases are. Many of them are clearly genetic in origin. There's gene therapy, which is successful. You can genetically modify some of these cells, which could be stem cells or induced stem cells, even from skin or mucosa. Modify them, put them back, autologous cells, and thereby you will be able to correct some of these genetic defects. In the area of true cell therapy for rare diseases, bone marrow transplant or hematopoietic stem cell transplant is something which is a standard of care. And we've been doing it. We've known this as a curative treatment for thalassemia, sickle cell. And if you want to go beyond that, then you need to look at various newer mechanisms which I will allude to in some of the specific slides. So this is just the spectrum when you talk about cell-based therapy. So you could use hematopoietic stem cell, you could use mesenchymal stem cell, you could induce pluripotent stem cells and use them, or you can go on to gene therapy where you can do gene editing or gene modification. So this has already been alluded to, the frequency of rare diseases. And then we have the subset of thalassemia and hemophilia coming into this perspective. Some of the trials in gene therapy, you've got a lot of diseases listed there. And work has been going on. You can see all of them are clinical trials which are enrolled. A lot of them working primarily, initially started off with lentivirus, and then it's gone across to adeno-associated viruses, and then recombinant adeno-associated viruses. So these are the vectors which are used to actually transform or make these genetic modifications in cells and then put them back. And various trials are on. I'm not going to go through all of them, just to give you a flavor of what's happening. And in the area of stem cell therapies, similarly, you can see the list of diseases which are listed there: Gaucher's, Fanconi, Biscott outbreach. You've got inborn errors of metabolism, which was spoken of in the previous talk. You've got sickle cell and thalassemia. So in this area, there is already a clearly defined treatment, which is stem cell transplant. And we've all now progressed from there. Once upon a time, it used to be horrendously expensive to do this. But nowadays, you've got a lot of centers in India itself. In our last meeting, the National Meeting of Transplanters in Vellore a week back, now we have 75 centers in the country which can offer bone marrow transplant. So this is a huge jump. You know, about 10 years back, we hardly had 10 or 12 centers. You've seen Dr. Vanakar mention about the fact that transplant now, there are centers which the government is also funding, 9 lakh transplants for thalassemia. So this is a great step forward for this subset of diseases with a curative intent. But obviously, there's a little rider there. These are results which you do get, you know, the best outcomes when it's done very early, at a young age. As people age, then it becomes a little more complicated and more life-threatening. And thereby, in those situations, you will have to look at gene therapies. So I regularly have the adult thalassemic patients come and tell me, when is gene therapy coming to India? You know, because they've kind of crossed the limit for stem cell transplant, because the complications tend to go up with age and iron overload. So in them, the only option then becomes gene therapy, and we need to take a step forward in that direction to help these patients. Just last week, I did a search on the clinical trial website and saw the list of trials which are ongoing. It's impressive that you've got so many of them running as of now in these areas of rare diseases. Clearly, data coming out. The Thalassemic Society would have heard about Bluebird's data, what they've presented on sickle cell and thalassemia. It's crossed the phase 1-2 study, and you're having patients now who are transfusion free, and we're having follow-ups which are beyond 24 to 36 months where they are transfusion independent. This is a big step forward in the area of thalassemia and gene therapy. Similarly, this article published in the New England Journal of Medicine just last year about the success achieved in sickle cell disease. So there again, you're able to correct the defect using gene therapy, using various viral vectors, and thereby, you know, cure this disease. Slowly, longer and longer follow-up data. Now, in last year's American Society of Hematology meeting, there was this big plenary session. And here they got the two big names in gene therapy actually specially invited to come and give this talk. And they were actually honored at this session. And the two names are Lulgi Nardini and Marina Cavanza, both of them who've done, primary work in gene therapy in thalassemia and sickle cell disease, and they presented their data. Again, a lot of the talk at that meeting was on the CAR T cell therapy, which is the new big thing in immunotherapy for malignancies. First data on relapsed leukemia. The child now, I will show you that picture, is more than 5 years post-therapy, achieved a cure. You know, this is somebody with relapsed refractory leukemia, which has an extremely poor outcome. You know, even with transplant, we have, you know, cure rates of about 20% kind of range. And this is something, if you've got 5-year cure rate, this is something really worth talking about. And thereby, so much of advancement in that field, they've gone on to all the hematological malignancies, and they're now also looking at solid tumors to kind of bring up this immunotherapy concept. Now, if you look at it from a conceptual point of view, it's a great way because you're actually getting your own T lymphocytes to target the cancer cell. You've gone beyond chemotherapy, targeted therapy. This immunotherapy is what is truly curative in the long term because you're remodeling your own cells to recognize the cancer cell is different and kill it off, and that prevents it from coming back. So this typically translates into a long-term cure. Just one cartoon basically to tell you what are the other things which we talk about when we talk about these pluripotent stem cells. You can take stem cells from anywhere, the skin, muscles, or your mucosa, modify it, use various enzymes, genetically modify, correct the defect which is there, and put it back. You can also take mesenchymal stem cells from the bone marrow, use them to kind of get other autocrine factors to be secreted to try and correct some of the other enzyme defects which are correctable that way. So this is the newer therapies which are available most specifically for the rarer disorders where some of this is required. Just to give you a flavor of our data on bone marrow transplant, this is our curve. We're kind of crossing 200 transplants a year. So this is a done thing for us for thalassemia. And you can see that the cure rates are pretty high when it is done very early. And clearly we need to address the generation which has gone beyond that and how we can offer treatments for that. In the area of leukemia and some of the other disorders, obviously we are still in the 40-50% range for a curative intent treatment, and that's not good enough. You still need to look at other diseases, other mechanisms to kind of provide better cure rates for the subset who cannot be cured with just transplant alone. This is our facility for transplant, and basically our plan is that the way forward is to now get into areas of immunotherapy which can then bring about a curative treatment for a lot of other subset of diseases. Now, just a few slides on what Dr. Kiran had already mentioned in the morning about collaborating with the industry. Some of these things cannot be done with just academic institutions alone, where research is possible, but the moment you want it to translate into patient care, you need industry and pharma to come in and get involved. And the success stories are only when that has happened. So the first one was in the severe combined immunodeficiency, ADA. So this is where the retrovector was used about close 20 years back. First child and patient called Ashanti De Silva, who had a cure. GSK collaborated and took this forward, and now it's kind of available. Similarly, Jimton, which is the French group, they've come up with this gene therapy for myotubular myopathy with this replacement of the deficiency there. And this is how collaborative studies have come forward and taken this forward for the rare disease. So what was also mentioned in the morning was, we cannot always club it and say that, you know, this is an exception, we will bypass all the regulations and then try and get it. And that's not kind of the model you want to go. You want to fulfill all the GMP criteria and go the right route, but get funding and faster clearances from the government agencies so that this is accessible to a larger number of patients. Review article recently published, gene therapy returns to center stage. So there was a little lull when we had some problems. There was a death associated with gene therapy in one of the patients who had it in 1999. There was a little dip in the treatment protocols. A lot of things were changed. After that, it's now come back with a bang, and this is the person who I spoke to who also gave that plenary lecture there. Now, if I just put a list of all the therapies available, you can see a lot of it in thalassemia using the lentivectorial virus. And then you can see follow-ups, which is slowly getting longer and longer. People with stable engraftment and transfusion independence. In the area of hemophilia, again, the AAV8 using a vector being used, which is a liver-directed gene therapy. Again, trials are on, follow-up coming up. And immunotherapy for cancer. A lot of it is the hematological malignancies, like acute leukemia, lymphoma, again, good follow-up. And the impressive thing here is, if you look at the response rates, in some of them, it's as high as 90 to 100%. So this is the data in, which is coming up in somebody who's had relapse of a cancer. So like I told you, normally we're only talking 20-30%. If some treatment can give you this high response rates, then it's certainly something which is worth looking at. And this is across multiple centers. Again, similar data for retinal gene therapy. So just a few slides on the pioneering work which has happened in the field of the CAR T-cell. Carl June was the person who first initiated for a child with relapsed leukemia. And we have 5-year follow-up data now. This is now coming up in a big way, except the horrendous cost, which is currently extremely expensive in the US. So I was actually talking to Dr. Kiran in the morning and asking, how can we make this available in our country and bring down the cost and make it, accessible to a larger number of our patients who actually need it. Just the principles of CAR T-cell therapy is basically you're re-educating your T-cells to identify the cancer cell and kill it off. So it has to be very specific for that. When you do it for the hematological malignancies, it's very, very successful. But in solid tumors, sometimes you have a problem of cross-reactivity, and thereby there is some fine-tuning which is required. And sometimes innocent bystander cells can get killed off. And that's one of the drawbacks which is getting fine-tuned now, and hopefully that should fall into place in the next 1 or 2 years. I will end with this last slide, who is actually the person who was the first person child to receive CAR T-cell therapy for relapsed refractory leukemia. This is more than 5 years ago. Absolutely disease-free, cured, and this is the follow-up we have. Except the cost, which is currently, horrendously expensive, we are looking at these kind of therapies now being made available in our country for our subset of patients, and definitely with collaboration among centers, the cost can be brought down, just like how the cost of bone marrow transplant at one point in time was almost unaffordable, and now it's kind of standard of care in the country. So I'll end with this last slide and hopefully take a few questions. Thank you.
So I think personally gene therapy, the only reason why the costs are exorbitantly high is because there are a lot of costs which are imposed, levied upon it, such as the patenting costs. And so why can't the government or why can't higher authorities bracket off those costs, or I don't know. Because for it, the cost that gene therapy is available right now, and to come down at what it should be for us, it's going to take a long time, I feel.
True.
Let me also just mention before Sharat answer that we'll have a couple of more talks today of groups that are actually trying to set up GMP plants here to make the nectar product. So Dr. Arka Ghosh from Narayana is here, Dr. Alok Srivastava from CMC is here. And I think they're addressing exactly this issue. How do we make it here, make it at a reasonable cost? And
so that's precisely part of the answer. We need to have groups in our country to initiate this kind of work and get the viral vector. We can't just go at that cost and say, if you procure it by buying it, then it's going to be horrendously expensive. So we have to get some groundwork done here, for which one essential criteria is to have a GMP facility, which is now actually coming up in various parts of the country. Other than Bangalore, there are at least 4 or 5 centers who are seriously looking at establishing this, so that is then accessible to our own patients. Once that happens, then the cost will straight away start coming down, because then we'll also get partly driven by numbers, and those numbers we have significant already, so that will then drive it further down. So clearly we are in that phase. In fact, that's why I was kind of highlighting that there is data now coming up on follow-up of these patients, of these trials done abroad, and slowly once we replicate those here, clearly it will start becoming available at lesser cost for sure. But it has to be done in-house. We can't depend on just importing stuff and then saying that we'll offer it.
So since it will be just a segment, since it will be in-house, will we have to go again with the trials?
So that's precisely what we're trying to say, that we need to bypass and fast track,
Sure.
That.
So actually, Dr. Nitin Bhai is here already, but we have been working on setting up the guidelines for ICMR on gene editing and gene therapy through the Tashishila Institute. And so Nitin will be here in the afternoon, and we can talk a little bit more about that. But I think, absolutely. So the regulatory pathways, all of this will have to be set up. But I think the first challenge was to get enough viral vector, the highest quality, made with the DNA payloads, you know, to be able to pull this off. And that challenge, I think, now
is kind of doable. And that's why I think, you know, we can't have a situation where we can truly move forward on our own.
You know, I would say in the last 15 years, the advances in Bangalore and in other parts of India, of course, on our capabilities in research biology have gone through huge change. India used to be known as sort of having a biology hold. We were very good for chemistry, but in biology we were never that capable. I think that change has happened. You know, a lot of credit to the Department of Biotechnology and agencies that actually built capacity. And today, like, you know, there is no doubt that the cell-based therapies, I think we are capable and we can actually achieve world-class, you know, solutions and things here at prices that always surprise the rest of the world. Right? Because I think because of our volume, our ability to Google engineering, abilities to, you know, make things. I work with Dart very closely, and I, you know, the amazing things that they're doing. It's not yet full gene therapy, but it's RNA therapy. They're able to do exon splicing. Their clinical studies will start any day now. So you know, I think seeing that capability actually yielding fruit. So I think it's a very good stage that we are in of taking on the challenge.
Thank you.